Peace, everyone. This is Queen Ifama. I am the Truth Seeker, and I'm sharing another broadcast that I did on Live 365 in 2006. And what really sparked this particular broadcast and the rant that ensued as a result of it was a news article that I got of these two little girls named Lynx and Lamb, who were at one point touted as, I think they called them, the face of hate. I think that's what they called them, the face of hate, or the new face of hate, or the new faces of hate, yeah, is what they called them. And so now today, they've changed their tune, and they say that the reason that they've changed their views is due to marijuana. They say that marijuana changed them from Nazis to peace-loving hippies. Now, their pop band, which was called Prussian Blue, was named after a gas that was used on the Jews in the concentration camps. But today, they've said that they've grown up and that they're pretty liberal now. And both of them are on prescribed medical marijuana. Now, when they were 11 years old, they formed this band, and they began to see themselves as the new faces of pop music. As a matter of fact, in my rant, it'll tell you that they got on Billboard and everything else. And as I said, they were, you know, now known as the new faces of hate. But their mother actually was the catalyst behind those girls. Okay, from the time, I believe, of gestation. So they can claim that they've changed their ways, but if you listen to their language, their current language, they have not really changed their views. They're just taking another approach. Just like the hippies of the 60s and the 70s, they now walking around here in suits and ties and being administrators and managers and over some of y'all out there. And me too, actually. Okay? Now, these were pretty, you know, they were little girls. You know, people love little girls back in the day, in 2003, I think it was. And, you know, okay, they blonde. Of course, you know how much they love blonde people. And these were two little blonde girls that happened to be twins as well. And I'm going to make this short because the video, is the other part is going to be long enough. But, you know, this is how the universe does. Now, they were, 10, 11 years old then. Now, they're in their 20s. 21, 22, something like that. But the one named Lynx was diagnosed with cancer during her freshman year of high school. I mean, right after she was spouting that shit. Okay? And then they had to get a tumor off her shoulder. And then she was given these drugs like oxycodone and morphine so that she can deal with the pain. And eventually she started smoking weed. She also got a rare condition called cyclic vomiting syndrome. Look it up. Cyclic vomiting syndrome. So after 2 years, you know, about 2 years, she says, she's about three or four years now, she began to smoking marijuana to ease the withdrawals. And finally, she got, you know, because California, they give you that kind of stuff. And I guess in other places too, but I think they're in California now, that now she gets the prescribed medication. But guess what? It didn't just happen to her. Something happened to her sister too. Her sister suffers from scoliosis, chronic back pain, which leads to emotional stress. And she soon acquired a medical marijuana card of her own. And see, people don't understand. That's what happened in the Black Panther Party too, is that they start smoking weed real heavy. And that's what took the fire out of their asses. Just where they couldn't even think straight. I just got to put that on record. Marijuana has its ups and downs. Like I said, with everything, there's a time and place to do it. Okay? And you don't do marijuana when you're taking care of business. Simple as that. But anyway, she said, now Lamb says, we just want to come from a place of love and light. I think we're meant to do something more. We're healers. We just want to exert the most love and positivity we can. Now, check this. See, I'm telling you, you don't move too far from your core ideology. I just got to put that on record. This says, I'm glad we were in a band, but I think we should have been pushed towards something a little more mainstream and easier for us to handle than being front men for a belief system that we didn't completely understand at the time, said Lynx. Okay? And it says, they go to talk about the different philosophies they was raised in a redneck community and that they were indoctrinated with extremist principles. I contend that they were born with those extremist tendencies. And she said lots of things were exaggerated about the Second World War. This was young Lynx when she was a teenager. She said a lot of things were exaggerated about the Second World War. We don't believe that 6 million Jews were executed. I mean, there were not even that many Jews alive then. We know that there were concentration camps, but they had swimming pools and tennis courts. That's not how you treat people if you were getting ready to kill them. I ain't never heard that they had no swimming pools and tennis courts in the concentration camp. You know, I can't disclaim it. I just have never heard it. And in 2005, they donated money to the victims of Hurricane Katrina, but they were specific as to where they wanted their money to go. They wanted their money to go to white people only. Okay? And this guy named Louis Theroux, he did a documentary about Nazis in 2003, and they featured those young girls in that movie. But now, they said they just didn't know any better, you know, at that particular time. Lynx is now a painter and a furniture restorer, and she lives with her mother, and she, you know, explaining their behavior, you know, and excusing, trying to, you know, get us to understand why they did the things they do, which is unbelievable to me. But she said, my sister and I were homeschooled. We were these country bumpkins. We spent most of our days up on the hill playing with our goats. Now, Nam is a hotel maid who lives not too far from mom and her sister. And she said, I want you to listen to these words, because words say a lot, people. She said, I was just spouting a lot of knowledge that I had no idea of what I was saying. Now, if they were so, changed, they would look back at that stuff they were saying and call it garbage. But no, she still calls it knowledge. All right. So, you know, they said that Lynx and Lamb were enrolling in public school and moving to Northwest Montana. Oh, they said that enrolling in public school and moving to Northwest Montana has helped them become more open-minded. Check this out. Now, mind you, Lynx still stay with her mama. Her sister don't stay too far from her mama. However, they said their mother still has dreams of forming an intentional white community in Montana called Pioneer Little Europe. Now, they went to public school in Northwest Montana, but I bet you they ain't go to school no black people. And if they did, there was very few black folk that was going to that school. I bet you that. Okay? I bet you that. So, you know, but they said that they're reluctant to follow her lead. Lamb says, I am not a white nationalist anymore. My sister and I are pretty liberal now. Yeah, they probably using their ideologies in a whole different way. You know, a whole different way. I'm telling you, because when you have that core ideology, you can mask that shit and get out in the public and pretend like you are for people, but you working against their best interests all the time. You have no love for them. You have disdain for them. You hate them. You know, Jews and black people, you know all them, how them Nazis feel, right? You know, them white Nazis, they don't like blacks. They don't like Jews. They don't like Latinos. They don't like none but white people. You understand? So, they also said that since they, closed the doors on the Prussian Blue episode in 2006. They, after their 2006 European tour, they've been spending like the last few years, check this out, laying low and trying to live a normal life, laying low. And then they say they worry about a lot of backlash from their former fans. But see, they have to lay low because we're in a totally different time. And, you know, you get a lot of flack for having those kind of ideologies. I mean, I don't give a damn if you is a white nationalist or whatever. Even black folk who talk violent, you know, talk like they talk, would get, you know, a whole lot of press because that's called hate speech. And so, of course, the media and everybody else gonna be hounding your ass all the time. So they had to lay low, as they said here. It says that one of them, Lamb, said that there are dangerous people in white nationalism that don't give a fuck, and they would do awful things to people who they think betrayed the movement. They said, we're stepping on eggshells. Okay, that's because they had to go down. No, because they're trying to cover it up. Like I said, you got them same people in them hoods and all that other kind of shit. They got suits and shit on now. You can't tell them from your most real liberal white person. I mean, who truly believes in racial equality. And there is some white people who really believe that. They really believe in that. Okay. But at the end of the day, they all white. At the end of the day. But thank God for those who, you know, have a little bit more sense. You know what I'm saying? But anyway, they said, this article ends this by saying this. The sisters are not completely reformed. And I told y'all. It says, asked whether the Holocaust happened. Lynx replied, I think certain things happened. I think a lot of the stories got misconstrued. I mean, yeah, Hitler wasn't the best. But Stalin wasn't. Churchill wasn't. I disagree with everybody at that time. And Lamb said, I just think everyone needs to freaking get over it. That's what I think. They want you to get over and forget with their part in this shit. When they was the face, the newest, youngest faces of hate in 2004, was it? 2000, something like that. I'm telling you. So anyway, this is Queen Ifama. I hope you enjoy the broadcast. And it's got two parts, just like the other one. But I hope you enjoy it. Peace, everybody.
Peace and blessings. This is Sister Ifama coming to you from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And you are listening to Ifamathink Radio, and I just got to say it. We're going to do another segment of the Black News. And I wanted to warn you before we get into the segment that you take your children out of the room because Sister Ifama is going off today. So I wanted to warn you because I don't want the little children to hear the profanity that I'll be using spontaneously sometimes, because sometimes I just really get over exacerbated reading some of the things that I read. And I hope if you're a little sensitive that you excuse me as well. So I'm apologizing up front, so that you can't say that Sister Ifama just spraying that stuff on you. So this is Sister Ifama coming to you from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and we're going to get right on into the broadcast. Peace and blessings. This is Sister Ifama coming to you from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and I got a lot of news to talk about today. This is Sunday, October 1st, 2006, and we're going to jump right in here, and we're going to talk about this piece I got from one of the listservs that I'm on, and it's entitled Racist White Girl Group on Billboard Charts. Now, what it talks about, it says, what does it mean for Black America that a hate-preaching rated music duo could debut on the Billboard album's charts? Well, it means that you in America, dummy. That's exactly what it means. Jesus Christ. You think these white people done changed their attitudes about Black people just because we done had a few civil rights bills passed? Hell no. They have not. And if you really scrutinize the average white person, you'll find so much damn racism, it'll be unbelievable to you, even your so-called white friend. They still have those tendencies. I'm telling you, it's there, a seal. And you need to understand it. Now, they're talking about this pop duo called Prussian Blue. Now, they're only 12 and 13-year-old girls named Lamb and Lynx. And they put out an album that sold 91,000 copies in the first week entitled End of a Black World. Did you hear what I said? Entitled End of a Black World. Not only that, this album is also going to be the soundtrack for the remake of one of the most controversial movies in United States history, Birth of a Nation. Now, you know it was right after that that the Ku Klux Klan really stepped up and Black people were swinging from trees like monkeys, but dead. You know it and I know it. You think things have changed in this country? Hell no, you just have not protected yourself. And I'm telling you that any time white people get it in their mind that they want to do something to Black people, they just do it. You understand what I'm saying? That's why Black people are never safe in this country. Because when white folks get beard up, liquored up, or whatever they do, and they decide that they want to take it out on some Black person, that's exactly what they do. James Byrd knew it. He lived with him. He knew it. They drug his ass behind a truck, and he knew those people. Drug his ass behind a truck till his whole head popped off. You know it and I know it, and that's not an isolated incident. That's a reported incident. Happens all the time. It's unbelievable. But here are these little girls, 12 and 13, Lamb and Lynx, out here sprouting this stuff in an album, and Billboard make them number 4. What does that say to you? And then Ted Shaw, who's the civil rights advocate and president of the NAACP's Legal Defense Fund, you know, he's really mad about it because he's like, it just breaks his heart to see those two girls spewing out that kind of garbage. Well, Ted, wake up. You are in America. Jesus Christ. You know, and see, that's what kills me is that, and I don't know if Ted Shaw is Black or white because I'm not very familiar with those civil rights advocates. But if he's white, he's one of them damn liberals. And if he's Black, he's one of those stupid Negroes. This shit is live and well in America. It ain't never die. And all the legislation you can come up with is not going to stop the attitude of white people when they get it in their minds that they want to do something to a Black person. You understand me? I hope you do. Because see, this right here is solidifies what I say about white people. You know what I'm saying? Because when we're talking about a collective, not no damn individuals, because you know, once they get in the flow of things, they all will do something. I'm going to tell you the truth. It's kind of like gang mentality or group mentality. You know, you have one dude, you be in one of them tailgate parties out there at one of the ball places, wherever mostly white people go. And you let some shit jump off, and they all liquored up against a Black person. And you see what happened to you. Now, you may have a white friend and may stand in for you. But I'm going to tell you, he going to get his ass whooped, too. So I'm telling you, you are in America. America is racist, always have been, always will be. And these 12 and 13-year-old girls, this is not nothing new. And you so want to send your kids out there with these damn people. I'm telling you, it's unbelievable. Now, Ted got a little upset because he said this is bullshit.
He said right now he's so shocked that an album advocating the extermination of the black race could be so widely received by America. Ted, wake up. You are in America. This is a racist country against black people. Always have been. And why we just think that things are just changing, it's unbelievable, because they let you go to school with them, let you go to a restaurant and sit by them, because they let you shop in their stores with them, let you spend your money with them. You think that everything is all right? Haven't you looked at the damn statistics of the disparities of black people here in this country? I'm telling you, I don't get it when black people say stuff like this. It's unbelievable to me that they just don't see what's going on. I work with white folks all the time. But I'm going to tell you, those are mostly professional people. But I'm going to tell you, when I saw them in the raw, because I've never been around white people in their element, in their neighborhoods. And when I did that event for those little 8 hours that I was over there, I saw some pretty sorry-ass white people. And I'm telling you, I was so happy to get away from there, because I'm going to tell you about a liquored-up-ass Peckerwood. He will say some shit out of order. And when you step to his ass in his element, all his people go step behind him. I'm telling you. So, you know, all this equality shit and what you can't believe and how shocked you are, Ted, you better get used to it. You better understand what's really going on. Talking about he go call for black artists to boycott Billboard. Boycott Billboard? They ain't got a boycott Billboard. Billboard has boycotted them. We've been begging to get on Billboard. What the hell are you talking about? I don't get it. I'm going to tell you what Jesse Jackson said. See, Jesse Jackson know what's going on. You know, the brother may have his problem. But one thing I can say about Jesse. Jesse knows what's really going on. Jesse said this. Love it. White America has spoken. Billboard has spoken. This is only the beginning. Now, that was from Jesse Jackson. Y'all can call him messy if you want to, but this is one time that Jesse said something very, very pertinent as far as I'm concerned. White America has spoken. Billboard has spoken. This is only the beginning. You hear what I'm saying? See, it says that these two young girls have been nurtured on racist beliefs since birth by their mother, April. And they are hoping for, they said, we hope to bring about a change in our people. Now, that's Lil Lamb. Now, I don't know, Lamb, I guess, is the one that's 13. She says, we hope that our album and A Birth of a Nation will show our people exactly what needs to be done to make this country safe and white. Did y'all hear what I just said? Safe and white. Now, for those of you who want to read this article, you can go to www.playahata.com. That's PLAYAHATA.com. And you can read the whole damn article. Because a lot of y'all walking around here with your heads in the freaking sand. And I'm telling you, especially in this liberal, so-called liberal, racist-ass town called Milwaukee. Because on one hand, you got the freaking liberals. And then on the other hand, you got the freaking, I don't know what's on the other hand. Because they all the same to me. But these liberals been making their living off your ass. Off of your damn disparities about the poor little black people. And they've been coming up with all these damn programs. Won't let you help yourself. Come up with all these damn programs to help you. But they ain't doing nothing but making a living for themselves if they be directors and all that shit of all these various programs. And these Negroes here in this town keep going for it. They're unbelievable. But you know what? You are not going to believe. I'm going to read some stories out of the local news here for you so that you can get an idea of exactly what's really going on here in the Midwest in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Now, I don't know what's going on in Chicago because they had kind of like a different history with their black people than they have in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Because wasn't nobody welcoming your ass up there in Illinois. But they was welcoming you here in Wisconsin and hiding you out from the slave catchers. Because this was part of the Underground Railroad. So you know you've always had those benevolent whites who tried to help black people, even though they still felt superior to you. They tried to help you so you wouldn't, you know, be a slave, but you were still mentally a damn slave to their asses and their so-called generosity. It's unbelievable. But anyway, you know what? The actor, the comedian that they really, really were inspired by was Dave Chappelle. And she and one of the little girls, Lynx, and I guess that's the little 12-year-old, she said, "I saw white people hating white people. I was afraid that America wanted to be black." Girl, you know what? She's as dumb as all the rest of them damn Negroes I'm talking about. Because don't nobody want to be black in America, to be honest. Not even black people. It's unbelievable. I'm going to tell you what happened yesterday. I was in a store, and this young guy who be hustling oils all the time, you know, he runs in and out the store getting his little $2 oils, and, oh, it's just really, you know, he just be hustling, right? So, you know, he hustles the parking lot around the store. So, you know, I said, I was sitting in there, I'm saying, "You're African, right?" And he was like, "What?" I'm like, "You know you are an African, right?" He was like, "I don't know no Africans, I ain't never been to Africa." I'm like, "Son, you ain't got to have been to Africa or know any Africans to be African. That is what you are from. You are from the lineage of Africans." He was so damn baffled. Now, here's a young man. I guess he got to be like 30 or 32 or something like that. He don't know who in the hell he is. Yeah, see, my husband just handed me a little note. He said conservatives preach keeping the niggers down, and the liberals want to change every fucking body, I guess. But I'm going to tell you, and you know what? He's absolutely right. See, liberals want to change, because the liberal, I guess, and this is what I think about the damn liberal. The liberal wants to have the appearance that everything is fair and equitable, and, you know, we want everybody to be equal. That's the liberal. The conservative want to conserve shit and keep it just the way it is, all for white people, all for white people, and black people, you just stand in line and get your freaking crumbs. And they're right out front. But the liberal want to give you your crumbs and give you an illusion that you're in some kind of equal status with them. And that's bullshit. But anyway, it says that Prussian Blue, which is the name of this little group. Well, anyway, let me get back to Dave Chappelle. So the little girl said that she was afraid that America wanted to be white. She says, "I saw that funny," and they got those little number signs, but I know what it mean. It mean nigger. "I saw that funny nigger show where he made a mockery of the KKK and white people were laughing." She says, "This broke my heart." Now, this is a 12-year-old girl. Can you imagine what the adults are saying? Can you imagine what? And this is not no small minority of America in American white society. I'm going to tell you the honest to God truth. Because I, you know what? I'm going to tell you something. It's something about white people, particularly when they know that you are pro-African. It's something about them, how they treat you. You know what I'm saying? And all those liberal ass peckerwoods around there where I work at, I know. I feel how they really, really think about black people. They just make their damn living off of black people. But this here, these will be the main ones. And I'm going to tell you, a good book to read is No More Nigger Thinking. And it may be out of print. Now, you may be able to find it if you go to your public library. But in the beginning of this book, this man was talking about, he was a reporter in Chicago, and he was talking about how they were covering the, not the segregation, but the integration of the public housing. Now, we're talking about the freaking projects The integration of the public housing on Cicero in Cicero, Illinois, which is just like right across, you go across the tracks, you in Cicero. So it's really still Chicago, but the white folks segregated themselves just like they do every damn where else and call it another county or something like that. But anyway, black people just wanted to get out there with them white people so they could be in the projects with the whites. You know, we are unbelievable group. But anyway, so as they were covering this particular integration thing, because they had started having trouble because a black family moved out there in the damn projects. And man, them hunkies went off. Do you hear me? And so the black reporter had to hide in the back of the car down on the floor because these peckerwoods was going off out there. You understand what I'm saying? And so he said he kind of peeped his head up and he said he was just looking at people who were ordinarily, you wouldn't dream that they would be involved in no kind of gang mentality, mob mentality that he saw taking place there. But he saw them snatch black people out of cars who was dumb enough to be driving through that area, snatch them out of cars and beat the dog shit out of them. He saw that. He said ordinary white people you wouldn't think would have women, children, but all you got to do is look at the pictures that they took during the Reconstruction period, during the early 1900s, while they were standing around hung and charred bodies, smiling, having picnics and all that shit, while black people were getting killed. These motherfuckers ain't lost that spirit. They the same goddamn people they've always been. You know it, and I know it. Now, we may wish that one day little boys, little black boys, and little white boys, and little black girls, and little white girls could hold hands and sing in an old Negro spiritual, but that ain't going on. I'm telling you the truth. That is not going on, and I'm telling black people that your ass better be aware of what's going on. You know, you always got your one solitary black ass off somewhere in a group full of whites. You never know when just one of them motherfuckers have a bad day and blame it on your people. And there you are, the motherfucking little pepper in a whole shaker full of salt. And it don't take much. And try to talk back and see what happened to your ass. You can get brave out there with all them white people. You think your white friends gonna stand up for you? They gonna get their ass whooped too. I'm telling you. And call nigger lovers and all kind of shit. I know white people. They don't fool me. I ain't fooled by their fucking friendship or nothing. Because I know them. And like I said, I could be cordial. I could even be very friendly. I can even happen to like some of them. But I know them. And I don't trust them. And that's just the bottom line. And you got these little girls. And I'm going to tell you something. You sending your damn kids out there to them all white schools. You don't know what the fuck they going through out there. Because they ain't going to come home and complain to you. Because you're going to be like, oh, just don't pay them no attention. I can just imagine how those children felt. The first ones who had to go off into those segregated schools. And all those people lined on either side of them. Throwing shit at them. Spitting at them. Talking about them. And when they get up in the schools, how they separated them off and how they treated them. You think that didn't cause some more mental anguish for those children? You know what? We the most forgiving people I've ever heard. We will sacrifice our children to some bullshit like that. It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. Today I still can't get over 1950 something. When we sent our kids up in there and they had to go through all of that shit. All of that venom being, and so what do you think? They tried to be more like the white people. So the white people wouldn't attack them or wouldn't do them wrong. Same as today, it ain't no damn difference. Boy, I'm telling you, when I see black people, they be grinning like a damn Cheshire cat around white people. They don't even want to say the damn word white around white people. I remember my grandmother used to say, people. She didn't want to say white people. It's unbelievable. They don't want to say race. They don't want to have no dialogue that has to do with race. Unless it's in some kind of a professional setting whether they become their counterparts, their colleagues, then they can discuss race. Well, I'ma tell you, we need to talk about it and talk about it to them motherfuckers. And I'ma tell you, right here in Milwaukee, they got a white woman that comes to every motherfucking meeting that we have and don't no motherfucker know who she is. I'm like, who is, oh, that's just Kathy. Well, who in the fuck is she? Why is she always coming around y'all? Why y'all always let this person always up in y'all shit? She ain't black. She white. But they let her come on up in there. All them Negroes, ass stack and buff. Every fucking meeting that we have, that white woman be up in. And she's been coming up in there for years. And all them Negroes been screwing her too. It's unbelievable. But see, that just shows you how sick we are as a people. We want to be so like we ain't like white people. No, we ain't like white people. White people will kick your motherfucking ass. They will burn your shit down. They will burn you. Shit. You know, y'all better wake up. It's 2006 and shit ain't changed. Here you got two little white girls talking about the end of black America. Can you understand what I'm saying? The end of a black world. They talking about a whole fucking world. They talking about your damn world. The end of a black world. They ain't saying about the world or white world. Or they said the black world. What do you think that means? These is little girls. Apples don't fall too far from the tree. And it's a whole grove of them motherfuckers out there. That's what I'm here to tell you. I'm really upset about this. Because we continually let this shit go on and on and on. And we think it ain't nothing happening. But I'm telling you today, people. And if you don't come away from this with nothing but keeping your damn third eye open about white people, I'll be happy. Tell your white friends, I love you, but I know you. Let them know. As a matter of fact, you ain't got to let them know shit. You just be aware. And don't let yourself get caught up in those situations with them people. You know, because we have, boy, I'm telling you, you don't know. I bet you it's so much unreported racist shit happening to black people that it's unbelievable. That they don't make the news. It's just the real horrifying shit that makes the news. But all that little subtle shit that happen on an everyday basis, that does not make the news. But you think it don't happen? Well, hell yeah, it happens. And I'm telling you, it happens here, it happens in London, it happens everywhere white and black people are. I'm here to tell you. And I'm going to tell you. It's just unbelievable to me. Now, these little white girls became a success overnight. It said the group is now fielding offers from major record labels such as MGM and Geffen. I've never heard of Geffen. And they say this may only be the beginning. Well, that's what Jesse said. Now here's the track of End of a Black World. Dawn of a New White World, Birth of a Nation, Purest Soul, Tainted Blood. And you know what they talking about with that tainted blood. They talking about all you mixed Negroes out there who think you, just because you got a little white blood in you, that you will be accepted by those people. Affirmative Blackshin. Blackshin. Affirmative Blackshin. Regin and Ekik. Ekik. The Cleansing. And that's a damn interlude. Short Drop and a Quick Stop. Burning Cross. NAACP, which means Niggas Against a Colorless People. Funny Rich Nigga. Crack Babies. Nigga Lovers. No Darky in Me. End of a Black World. Hess Prayer. I guess Hess Prayer, I guess that's what that they're trying to say on that. So what I'm telling you, you listen to the titles of these songs, and they're number 4 on Billboard, and they're getting offers from MGM. You tell me what's really going on, and black people still trying to vote. It's unbelievable to me how unprotected. I remember when I first came to Wisconsin and moved to Milwaukee, I noticed these white boys walking through the black neighborhood with backpacks on And I was like, who are those? Because I know in Chicago, that wouldn't happen. They had been a step to them and said, what the fuck is you doing up in here? But here, they just sauntered through here like ain't nothing going on. White folks is safe on these streets. I'm here to tell you. A black person wouldn't dare step to them and ask them, what you doing in my neighborhood? Well, come to find out, these are some Bible-toting whites. And they go to people's houses and they preach the Bible to them. But my point is, you don't know what the fuck is in them damn backpacks. Because you don't step to them and you don't check them. That's my point. You just let anybody walk right into your neighborhood. You don't check them or nothing. And white people in and out these neighborhoods all the time. They work in your damn neighborhood, at your schools, teaching your kids. But I'm going to tell you something. And this is something that I'm finding out is that white people, when they kids get a certain age, they don't send them to the public school system if they can help it. And when they do, they very selective as to where they go. You understand what I'm saying? Because I know a lot of white people who kids go to private school, not only white people, black people too. They won't even put their own damn kids in the public school system, but they make their living off the public school system. I would advocate that people who work for the public school system, your kids should go to the public school system, because it seems to me that you'd have a vested interest if your own damn kids was up in there. But that's why the system is so fucked up. Because the people who teach there, the people who work there, they're not required for their own damn children to go there. So they don't have no vested interest in making sure that the children are educated properly. It's unbelievable. But see, you can educate a person all you want to. They can have all the education in the world. But if ain't no way for them to make a damn living, once they get all that education, it really doesn't matter. So, you know, all the economic development and all that shit plays hand in hand with that. I say if every black person, now we gonna get into this other article about the number of white black women going to college and the number of black men going to college, because we had continued that from the last piece that I did. But he says, now who said, somebody said, oh my God, I won't purchase any more. Oh, this is the person who wrote this. It says, oh my God, I will not purchase any more CDs, cassettes. I don't know where my dollars are going. I'll be damned if I want to contribute to this foolishness. The rappers had better come correct and stop the use of the N-word. White people are eating this up. Oh, so her thing is, it's just the fact that the reason this is like this is because we use the N-word. Dummy. That's because they racist. It ain't got nothing to do with using the N-word. What it has to do with is the fact that these people are the racist people that they have always been against black people. These poor white, and I'm going to tell you, be the poorest white ass person who is the biggest bigot. And I don't know if y'all looked at Archie Bunker when Archie Bunker was on. He's classic of that, ignorant as he could be, but he was classic of a mentality of white people. Normally, you know, just everyday Joe just says little shit about black people, but you let something jump off, they will be the first ones on the first row to pass the first lick to hit a black person. I'm telling you, you know, I'm telling you, this is, and she says, thank goodness for the internet, because I didn't see this on VH1's weekly countdown. Well, I don't look at VH1 weekly countdown, but I'm going to tell you the truth. I hadn't heard of this either. So, you know, black people don't take advantage of the internet. They don't read their goddamn email. They rarely check it. You understand what I'm saying? They don't know what's really going on. You know, they go surfing on the internet in them goddamn chat rooms. Ain't nothing you can learn in none of them. When I first got online, that's what I used to do. I used to go in the AOL chat room. I'm like, boy, these people ain't talking about shit. You know? So then I started surfing and coming across other things that I wanted to know about and learn about.